The Navy, all that's left of it, waits in northern ports for Allied captains to ring down the final finished with engines. Hands above its head, Admiral Donet's government gives up its reins of office. Surely the shortest-lived administration in history. For it had only been a few days before that the doomed Hitler had passed the leadership of Germany over to his favorite admiral. And no one was more surprised than Dönitz. One by one, fish large and small are swept into the net. Who's that little man? Von Papen, German Foreign Office brain of two world wars. Top brass. Military minds that for so long had to subjugate their experience to the intuition of Adolf Hitler. Old von Rundstedt, one of the best brains, forced to stake all he had left on the ill-fated Ardennes offensive. Kesselring, who once commanded the Luftwaffe in the Battle of Britain. Von Braun, master rocket mind. No longer will the world listen to the voice of Lord Haw-Haw. For now, William Joyce awaits trial for treason. Seyss Inquart, ex-Nazi boss of Holland, openly nervous, for he too must have a conscience. But where are the really top boys? In a villa at Lüneburg, a body lies on the floor. A broken phial of poison. Go tell the world that Heinrich Himmler is dead. The top boys. At a gas station in Milan, bodies hang head downwards. Such is the end of Mussolini and his mistress. Viva il Duce. At Birch's Garden, the eagle's nest is gutted. Gone that great window through which the Führer gazed and dreamt of world mastery. But the hills nearby yield riches. Out from caves and hiding places, the art wealth of Europe. Even through the greatest orgies of destruction, some things endure. And what of him who looted all this wealth? Well, at least we've got him. He's well worth interviewing and listening to. For Hermann Göring has a philosophy of life all of his own. But tell us, ex-number two of the Third Reich, where is number one? Petrol cans. A hole and burnt rags in the garden of the Berlin Chancellery. The only evidence with which to tell the world that Adolf Hitler's dead. Rubble, dust, and broken chandeliers. Fitting now for the Chancellery of the Third Reich. Into an office in the German capital, come Field Marshal Keitel and the last of the High Command. There they sit to face their conquerors and to put their signatures to the final surrender document. They take their time about it, though in truth they know that there is no escape. British, American, and Russian delegates sign, and that's it. They called it VE Day, Victory Day in Europe, for the world still had a Far East war on its hands. But for a Britain that had so long endured and resisted the monster on her doorstep, Victory in Europe Day was a big moment indeed. a moment to give thanks, to thank all those who had fought and those who had led along the road to victory. Into the Channel Islands marched the British troops, gladly welcomed by the liberated inhabitants of the only parts of the British Isles to be occupied by the enemy. With due ceremony, the Germans hand over Jersey, Guernsey, Alderney, and Sark. The Germans in Scandinavia, too, yield the seals of office. That's what they would like to have called it. But they found the conquerors in no such chivalrous mood. But there's nothing like putting a good face on things. But this is the face of utter defeat. And so they trooped out of Norway, Denmark, Italy, and Holland. With their going, it was as though a mighty weight had been lifted, even though what they left behind was destruction and exhaustion. In Holland, for instance, millions of precious acres lie flooded. For the Dutch, a bitter aftermath. But with freedom comes new strength. And already the pumps are busy. There's so much to do, but at least the doing has begun. Europe's greatest struggle is over. On the Belgian beaches, British Commonwealth troops enjoy a well-earned rest. For them, experience of things and pastimes so long denied, things and pastimes that had little or no place in total war. But it's a curious state, the war over, but still in uniform, like being kept in at school. But at last, Joe Smith picks up his kit bags and queues on the dock at Ostend to embark for Britain. If Joe is one of the younger ones, England will be for him but a stepping stone to the Far East and more fighting. But if Joe is a real old sweat, then probably is the magic destination, demobilization center. Demobilization was better organized than an old sweat would have thought possible. Of all the operations conducted by the Allies in the war, perhaps none was better planned than that designed to turn private or able seaman or air craftsman Joe Smith into a mister. It was all there for him, a suit to be chosen from quite an extensive range. And with that suit, personal attention that he's not experienced since he last paid for one himself. Ties and socks and shirts, shoes and braces, not to mention all the little things. It's the little things that count. Was this the face that fought at Arnhem, took those convoys to Murmansk, or kept that Lancaster flying? Not in that hat, but like the hat, it's all going to take quite a bit of getting used to. Because for Joe Smith, the change is a big one. Yes, for all of us, quite a bit of getting used to.